Start these things. When we go live, we're always in the middle of some story that's been happening behind the scenes.
Don't make this about me.
It's like we've got friends that now have walked into the store or the house while we were already in the middle of something crazy. And so, but anyway, we're here. We're live now. This is the live show on Thursday night. So it's a cool thing. I'm going to make the introductions and then we're just going to do like we did last time. This is such a joy for me. This couldn't happen tonight, and a whole lot of things in my life couldn't happen if it weren't for the technology that we've all kind of gotten used to over the last few years about Zoom and all that. Because our two guests tonight that are returning tonight, I have literally only met Anna through Zoom, and we've become friends. And John and I have had lunch one time. And we've become friends, and it's because of the technology. Oh, and Lisa and I've done a 2-year collaboration now.
Through Zoom. We've seen each other one time.
We've seen each other in person one time. It's all been on Zoom.
Jeff and I had lunch last year, and I'm starting to get hungry, man.
I am too. When you guys come back out here, we're doing it again.
we had breakfast, same here.
Yeah. I am just so honored. But the reason it makes this so special to me is because just like Lisa often says about our collaboration, how it's changed her life. The two people that are on here tonight have changed my life. They're good friends to have. Anna being a clinical psychologist, I got to have somebody to figure me out. so that's great. And her husband, John David Mann, has been my favorite author for a while. And I have said long before we even got acquainted that in my opinion, he's the best storyteller of our time. And I just get such a lift out of that. And now I'm actually getting the opportunity to be mentored by him. And he'll talk about what he's doing in his writing class. But these two people that are on here with you tonight, they've changed my life. And that just makes me so excited to bring them on. New York Times bestselling author, over 30 books written, sold over 3 million books total. That's a lot of books. I'm just going to let you know, that's a lot of books. Just tremendous author, tremendous couple. Everything about them I love, and I want you guys to love them as much as we do. So please welcome everyone, John David Mann and his lovely wife, Anna Gabriel Mann. So.
Jazz hands.
Yay. Hi, guys.
We got Peg on from the Go Givers. We got Patty Rubino from California, which is one of my Avon team members. And we got Teresa Staples and June. They're both buddies of mine that live close by. And yay, everybody.
We'll have a good crowd, I'm sure. Everybody likes you guys. And that's exactly what we want. So where should we start tonight? We're doing very informal tonight. John, I'll kind of pass the ball to you because I know there's several things you're doing right now that are helping me more than you'll. Well, I hope you know how much you're helping me. If you don't, more than you know how much you're helping me. But I'm going to kind of kick it over to you and let you kind of start. Tell us what's going on in your world.
Oh, nothing much. Thank you.
Okay. This is the point where I go, oh, no.
Daddy wants to know what's in your cup there.
Yeah. I've got no coffee. That's what's going on.
More or less.
Coffee. Yeah, and mine is Sprite.
Ah, more or less.
Yes. So pepper.
Oh, so yeah, that's on? Right. Sprite isn't pink.
I'll tell you what's going on. So since you ask, I do this class. I do this program. And Jeff is always, I open the Zoom room, and I always get an email notification when the first person shows up. That's and even if they show up before I open the room, and they're in the waiting room. You always get the email for the first person. And then after that, other people come in. You don't get notices for that. And every time I do a training, it's like I get an email. Bzzz, my phone buzzes in my pocket. I look at it. It's like, Jeff West has joined the waiting room. you are the guiding force of this program. So for years, I've wanted to find some way to coach people who want to write books. There's this thing that there's this sort of tragedy in my life. Which is, there's millions of people who have a book in them, one or more than one. People who have this book in them. It may be a true story. It may be something from their lives. It may be something they know about. It may be fiction. It may be a parable. It may be a fairy tale. It may be a novel. It may be a fantasy. It may be some expertise that they have where they change other people's lives. And they need to put it in a book, because then it could pass on to thousands, hundreds, thousands, millions more people than they'll ever reach personally. People have a book in them, and one of two things happens. They're either too intimidated to even think about doing it, or get scared off by the idea, or kind of don't know how, don't know where to start. Like, how do I do that? Or, you know, try and give up after a few efforts. And so the book dies with them, not to be morbid, but the book never gets born. It's like a possibility that never comes to pass. And to me, that's a tragedy. The other tragedy is people who do write the book. They do find a way, and in so many cases, get the book done, particularly in this day and age of self-publishing being such an easy thing to do and so accessible. People get it done, get it on Amazon, get the book out, maybe paperback, maybe just ebook, whatever. They get it done, and it's really only a shadow of what it could have been. It's like a cake that hasn't been baked all the way. It's been served on the table, and it's like it's not done. Great ingredients, beautiful idea, magnificent impulse, valuable experience, but it's like it's sort of only half done because they didn't have the coaching or the training or the they hadn't honed the skill set. And writing a book is not rocket science, but it's a little more complicated than walking and chewing gum at the same time. So I've wanted to find, you know, to me, I just wanted to find a way to help people take what's in them and bring it to fruition as a beautiful book, as a good book, as a great book that they can feel proud of and that changes people's lives, starting with themselves. I was telling a friend about this yesterday, and he said, yeah, imagine if your grandfather had sat down toward the end of his life and written out his experiences in World War II, or going through this Spanish flu epidemic of 1918, or maybe your great-grandfather, you know, grew up, was a child in the tail end of the Civil War, or whatever, the coming to America as an immigrant, or whatever their experiences were. If they'd put that between two covers of book and you had that after they were gone, to be able to pass on to your family, but to other people, and just to know it yourself and to have it. What a magnificent thing. So I want, you know, that's what I'm up for. But the challenge has always been, like, who has time? I don't have time to coach people because I'm too busy writing the darn books myself.
And so, it's funny because we often see self-published books come out that just are not ready for prime time. Yeah. And they're laid out badly, and they didn't get good, you know, designers, and they just don't have what it takes. And the book, you put the book down very quickly. And that's a real statistic, that people will pick up a book and put it down because it just doesn't draw them in. You know, when I read the pre-published copy of, you know, Said the Lady with the Blue Hair, I was sucked in like a tunnel, like boom. And that's what you want a book to do.
Oh, look at that proud papa look on Jeff's face.
I have to tell you a behind the scenes secret. After I finished writing the book, I hired my editor and had the editor do the work, but then I actually produced the book. And what I did, what you guys did, the formatting, the look of what you did on The Go-Giver Marriage, I just copied that formatting. I measured what margins you did. I made my chapters have the little squares around the numbers. I did everything just like you did it.
Yeah.
Because, if you're going to copy somebody, copy the best.
Well, you know, the Go-Giver Marriage, that format of that is exactly duplicate of the original Go-Giver, which, yeah, you know, we didn't do. We had a publisher, and they did a beautiful job. We loved it so much. You know, I just heard this the other day. Seth Godin, everybody knows who Seth Godin is, right? So Seth Godin has just published his, I don't know, maybe it's umpteenth book.
Something like that.
And he said what he has a secret. What he does is when he's finished his manuscript, he sends it off to a copy editor that he hires. Mm-hmm. And the copy editor totally goes through it. And then he sends it back to him, and he turns it into the publisher. And the publisher is like, oh my God, Godin turns in these perfect books. I'm illiterate, basically. Ideas on the page. But yeah, every there's the thing is to to create a finished book, as I said, it isn't rocket science. It isn't like you have to have gone to college. Dirty little secret, I never went to college. You don't have to have a degree. You don't have to go to school for years. So it's not formidable, but it needs to be, you know, better than the first draft. It needs to be it needs to be ready to get up on stage and give a presentation and not just, you know, fell out of bed.
Right.
So, so finally doing it. We got a program going. It's a one-year program. It's all online. Some is recorded. A lot is live. And just started it. What are we, May? We just started it like a month ago. We've only been doing this for a month, Jeff. My God. And Jeff was the first person that enrolled in the course. He's like my original. He's the OG.
Well, I was telling somebody behind the scenes that about signing up for the course. And I knew that was your first time doing a course. And I do know you have a sales background as well. But I knew this was your first time doing something as big as what you're doing now. And I said, John and I were on the phone. I had responded and we set up a call. And I said, we talked for a few minutes. And I said, how much is it going to be? And he told me, and I said, I'm in. And it's like, I probably spoiled him thinking that's the way all sales processes are going to be on the class.
Yeah, the next person, I was like, okay, hello, good to meet you. So he didn't say anything. It's like, what? Okay, so here's what it cost. You want me to say more?
Hey, John, can I ask you a question? When people ask me about doing a book, I tell them, and I want to know if you agree with this or not, I tell them they need to know who they're going to sell the book to, because ultimately they're responsible for finding the customers, basically. Now, is that bad advice or good advice? Or?
Man, it's great advice.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it isn't bad. It isn't good. It's great. Okay. And in two ways. In the first way is you need to know kind of who your ideal customer is. Oh, isn't that true for any business, by the way? But you need to know who your ideal customer is. And the way I pose that to the people is in a program is the people who are going to read your book, what else do they read? What are their favorite books? Don't give me the demographics. Tell me what they read, because your book is going to be in that camp, in that family, in that neighborhood. And so it already immediately tells you things about some choices. Is it going to be like a massive book? Is it going to be a short and quick and easy read? Are the paragraphs going to be long? Are they going to be very short? What kind of language is it going to use? You learn a lot about what you're going to write just by knowing what you want to people to compare you to. So if you imagine your book being out a year from now and you overhear someone saying, have you read Lisa's book? Or have you read whatever your name is, have you read their book? It reminded me so much of blank. What's the blank that you'd love to overhear people compare your book to? And then what's one of your favorite books? And think of what that's done for you. Your book could be that book that does those things for other people. It's like we all have that potential. But you also, as you said, you also need to know who's going to buy the book, because whether you go with a publisher or you're self-published, you're going to be kind of responsible for promoting it.
That's what I was going to say, is a lot of people say, I'm going to get a publisher, I don't need to worry about that. But yeah. I say, yes, you do. Yeah. They don't
publisher
find
publisher doesn't even want to publish you unless they think you've got a platform and can sell books.
Yeah. And I think that's common misconception is that.
Completely.
Yeah.
People assume the publisher is going to, you know, you write it and then the publisher takes it from there. Man, the publisher gets it ready and gets it into the marketplace, but it's your job to get readers to it, to let people know about it, to go out and by the way, that's something that you want to be doing long before the book is done.
And you also really need to know what your values are. You also really need to understand what your values are relative to the book you're writing, because using the Go-Giver Marriage as an example, you know, John's a brilliant parable writer. I mean, we all on this call know that, and lots of people listening know it too. But the Go-Giver Marriage, you know, to just say what the five secrets are and to kind of weave them into a story, you know, it's very sweet, but it doesn't explain what goes wrong in a marriage. It doesn't explain the opposite of the secrets. You know, each secret has an opposite, and the opposites are the things that tear marriages apart. And so when we wrote the book and I was writing the backside of it, that was sort of the explanation of each secret, I really felt very clearly that I wanted it first to explain the psychological reasons why this secret was important and why we need these kinds of things in our lives. But second, I wanted people to understand what the opposite of that secret was, because just to give you the example, the opposite of appreciation, you know, everybody wants to be appreciated. Everybody wants to have their spouse say thank you and tell them that they're handsome and, you know, whatever it is that you do to appreciate your partner. I mean, I appreciate John for all kinds of things, like doing the dishes, or, you know, it's just like, I don't let a moment like that slip away, because it's not assumed that he's going to do things like that. It's appreciated. And so there's that. But then the opposite of that is criticism. And criticism is death by a thousand cuts, and marriages are taken apart by it. But if we didn't have the understanding and the values of understanding that we wanted to write a beautiful parable, but then we wanted to unwrap it and explain it so that people could really take these secrets and put them to work in their life, that's, you know, if you don't know what you're doing when you set off to write your book, you won't be able to do it.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons that the Go-Giver Marriage is also one of my favorite books, just because it's the great writing that I always get to enjoy when John's writing a story. But it's also just, it's the how-to part in the back. There's so much in there that you guys have done that everybody that gets their hands on that book, it can change relationships. It can save relationships. And it's amazing. And it's one of the things that I'm very proud about. That I know we always yell out at people. We say, hi, Peg, Gwen, Laurie, Facebook user, Peg. Have no idea who, Maureen. Hi, everybody.
Yeah, Debbie Britt's on. Mary Walsh from Cape Cod. And Mary Fett, somebody said, love the necklace, Lisa. This is another direct sales company. One of my girlfriends does paparazzi. So this is a paparazzi necklace. So
alrighty.
Peg Duchesne, who was also in the class, John's class, she said, you don't need to be married to appreciate and learn from the Go-Giver Marriage. It helps in all kinds of relationships. Absolutely.
Absolutely.
That's awesome. And Gwen's on from Florida too. Cool. Awesome. And Maureen, sorry to miss you, Maureen. Maureen and Andrea from Jerseyville, Illinois.
Cool. Now, marriage is sort of a microcosm. I mean, it's because it's such a close and intense and long-lasting relationship, it kind of highlights and concentrates all the flavors of a relationship. But it's true for all relationships, with your employees, with your teammates, with your kids, with your parents, with your siblings, with your friends. It's just like human beings. We almost call the book, you know, the human beings in relationship Go-Giver. Very good title.
That one you might have had a hard time getting that one into the publisher.
And you know, it was important to us that it was a book about marriage, but there was discussion about calling it the Go-Giver relationship from one person that reviewed it. Yeah. And it's only, you know, just because it really does apply. I mean, it's an incredible. Those secrets are incredible for children. You know, they're great for business partners.
And Eunice from Maine is here too. I don't want to miss her.
Hi, Eunice.
Hey, Eunice.
Hey, John, one of the things that I have loved so far in the course, like you said, we've been doing this now, I think we've got four sessions in, or roughly a month in, is there are so many things in my own writing that I know that I've had to struggle through, or had to do this, and maybe I didn't have it gelled, and I thought I need to be getting that gelled, and trying to make myself relax and let the story take me where the story wanted to go in the first place, that kind of thing. And when you've talked about that in our course, and I hear you say things from your perspective on that, and I find out, wait, I'm not the only one who does this. And if I could do everything just like John does, even this part, I got this thing down.
I love hearing that, because that's like, you know, in the beginning of my book, How to Write Good, I started out talking about this one time that Anna and I went to hear Dennis Lehane give a little talk at our local public library. And you know, Lehane, who wrote Mystic River and all kinds of amazing books, you know, he is a superstar in the world of fiction. And he talked about how for months working on the current book he was on, he felt like he was driving a car out on a frozen lake surface, just kind of trying to get traction, sliding around and not being able to steer and not knowing where he was going. And it took him like 3 or 4 months before he found the lip of the lake and his tires dug into the actual frozen ground, and he got some traction and he could get somewhere. And it hit me like a thunderbolt, because like you said, it's exactly what I was going through. And I thought, if Lahane goes through that, then there's hope for me, because I knew what he produced. And that's the thing. So what, just to clarify, this is not a program like a formula or a curriculum where you do this first and then this and then this, and I'm going to tell you how to do it. It's, I really wanted to impart kind of what it's like to be a writer. And so much of it, because it's in your head, so much of it is working with your own, with the things that hold you back and the things in your own attitude and your own self-talk that get in the way. Because writing is a strange thing, and it doesn't matter whether you're writing fiction or nonfiction or a novel or a parable or what, it doesn't matter. When you're writing, you're calling into existence something that isn't there until you write it. You know, it's snatching concrete thoughts out of thin air, literally, and pulling it down, getting it on the page in such a way that when others read it, they go, oh, I get this. And that's magic. I mean, that's just magic. And because of that, you know, the only thing in between the ether and the page is you. So you're the conduit, but you're also what gets in the way.
And at times, I'm guessing it feels like the birth process, although I've never given birth, but at times it's work.
Yeah, Jeff and I are going to talk a little bit about the birth process now. We both have.
Kim Gilmore is on. I'm going to see her in August at the Avon Convention in Washington, D.C. And hey, Maureen's on too. The reason we're talking about this, everybody, is because you too can be in this class. You can be in this class. John's going to open it up. Do you want to? Because everybody's going, well, why are we talking about this if you can't be in it?
You have you have a book in you. Every one of you that's listening to the show has a book in you. And John said earlier, you know, what if your grandfather had written that book about his experiences in World War II? I have a dear friend that I went to high school with. Now, he was a track star in high school. And 2.5, 3 years ago, he decided to write a book about all his experiences running marathons and long distance running and races all over the world. And it turns out that he was dear friends with Bill Rogers, who was a famous marathoner, and a number of other famous marathoners. They were all buddies. They called themselves the Three Amigos, these guys. Anyways, they've been honored all over the world because they were some of the original marathon runners. And this every single chapter is just a delicious story about the friendships that he made along the way in this journey. And you know, when it was all over, you know, he didn't get a publisher. He ended up self-publishing. He has gone to bookstores all over New England. He lives in Rhode Island, and he goes to bookstores all over New England, stumping and talking, you know, telling stories from the book. And he sold a lot of books because he really got out there. But why he wrote this book was that he realized he was going to go to his grave and his children and his grandchildren and his descendants would never know that he was one of these original guys that was out there running 100 miles a week.
And here's the thing. He's not a writer. Right?
Yeah, not a writer at all.
He doesn't have a blog. He doesn't have articles in a magazine.
He doesn't own a laptop. He wrote it. He wrote it on a tablet. And it's an amazing book. Wow. I mean, John and I edited it. John designed the cover. I mean, we were just really into helping him get it done.
Wow.
Yeah. And it's like, you know, I stress it again. He's not a writer. This is not going to be his career to become a writer. This is something, he is a guy who had a book in him. And, you know, he hasn't sold a million copies or 500,000 copies. But you know what? He's made back his costs and way more than that. He's actually made a decent income. And now it's like in the golden years of his life, he's taken his entire life, in my point of view, he's taken his whole life and elevated it, added a whole new dimension of meaning to it and impact to it. And people come out to hear him talk about it. It's just so cool.
So, and if you know any writers, I mean, any runners in your life, they need to read this book. It's an incredible book. It's called On the Run by Joe Martino. And I mean, it's just an incredible book. I can't say enough about it. It's a special book.
Authentic, really personal. It's just like a letter.
And I used to run with him. I used to go run with him when I was first running in high school and beyond, like in, you know, 19, 20 years old, we'd go out for a 10-mile run together. And so, you know, I feel really privileged to have known him before he was like famous. You know, I mean, he became a famous marathoner.
We know, John, in the class, we've got people all different points of, of their writing life. Like, you know, I'm getting a ton out of it. I've already written things in, and I that's what I want to do the rest of my life. But we've got people from all different levels and different spaces. Could you talk a little bit about that? So we've had a lot of people in this group that have asked about writing books. And so that's perfect.
I love this too, because it's the diversity is so cool. I think it's so great. I think it's really good for every individual there to be surrounded by such different experiences than their own. I mean, you got people like Jeff. Jeff's written 2 award-winning parables. You know, he's already got he's got the laurels, the medal. Right? He's proved himself as a writer.
He's got the laurels.
He's a stud. Let's just face it.
But then we've got people in the program who've never written the book. We've got people in the program, and we're a month in now from the start. We've got people who don't yet know what their book is going to be about. We got a 22-year-old kid who's writing a 400-page fantasy sci-fi novel.
Wow.
We've got people who are writing nonfiction books about how to develop resilience in the face of horrible events and trauma. Someone who's writing we've got people who are writing about all kinds of, you know, sort of leadership and purpose in life kinds of principles, nonfiction books. And we got novels, and we've got a lot of parables. We got everything, memoirs. So as Lisa pointed out, I started the thing a month ago, but I'm reopening enrollment again. Starting right in June 1 through June 30, for the entire month of June, I'm opening up enrollment again because I'm ready for more people to join us. And the beautiful thing about the structure of the program is everybody's in a different place. So it's okay to join anytime. Yep. We have 2 live coaching calls a week, and you never know who's going to show up and what's going to be their question or their issues or whatever. And Jeff keeps pointing this out, and others have pointed it out too. They get in the call and somebody else is bringing up their issue. And like, they learn more about the dialogue we have about that person's issue than even the question that they brought to the call. So it's a really fertile, rich environment. You're really jumping into a pool of colleagues, basically. It's a real support group. And then there's also a once a week actual kind of curriculum training that I take people through that deal with all the elements of writing, starting with what does it mean to be a writer, and what is a writer's mindset, and what does a writer's daily routine look like, and developing a plan for yourself all the way through the points of, you know, language and chapters and paragraphs and word choices and how to improve your writing and elevate it and take a pretty decent draft and turn it into something that's magnificent as a finished product. You know, we're going to go through soup to nuts, but we also have that live weekly interchange that's just so cool and so refreshing and so unpredictable. And we're opening it up in June for new folks to dive in with us. So,
you know, I love it when you're talking, because I just look at my partner and he's
a fanboy over here, don't I?
You're just, oh, every word you say.
He's a hero of mine. What can I say? You know, one of my favorite things about the course, and I don't mind saying this, when you, in the growing up, the things in my childhood, critique was something I learned to just push away from and push. I'm not going to go into the whole story, but there's a lot of things that I just kind of pushed back on. In the process of the course, we'll all eventually start posting some of our material so that John or the others can put some critique in there and all that. And I'm one of these people, if John says we're going to do this, usually by the next day, I've got it done, it's up or whatever, because that's just the way I went through school and everything, I guess. But I had posted, I'm working on 2 books right now. One is a parable that I'm co-writing with someone, and the other is a novel that I'm doing that's mine. And I had posted kind of the opening scene of the parable. And John went in, he made some critiques that were just incredible. And number one, he starts off with the things that he likes, and he made a couple of suggestions on there, and the suggestions were so spot on. I actually retooled a little bit of it immediately because I thought they were so good. But awesome. Here's the difference. I didn't feel any of the negative emotion about critique because of the way John handled himself, number one. But also, I know without a doubt that he wants my book. I even said in the course that I know you want my book to be as good as I want it to be. So this was exactly what I needed. He said, I'm going to have to correct you. I want your book to even better than you want it to be. That's just who the guy is. So I can't encourage you all enough. If you've got the interest in writing a book, and even if you're not sure about yourself, at least check it out. Get some time with John when he opens up the course in June, for sure.
I just could say a word about critique since you brought it up. It's like we've got a rule. Actually, we've got two rules. We have a whole critique board. It's called the Critique Forum in our online community, the asynchronous stuff. And there are two rules on the Critique Forum. And the rules basically boil down to rule one is love first and then suggestion second. And the order of those is critical. And I'm really serious about it. And it's something I've learned. You know, I learned from my parents, but I also learned from my editors. A great editor will take your manuscript or take your sample or take your paragraph. And the first thing they'll do is say, okay, this is great. This is what I love about this. I see where you're going with this, and I think that's a fantastic idea. They will always start with what they love about it, and that's sincere. I mean, that's insight. It's not just like, hey, you did a great job. You're a champ. No, it's not like that. It's like, I love that you're doing this and this and going that way. That's brilliant because of this and this and this. And then once you've clearly delineated all the stuff that's great in here, then you make suggestions, and the suggestions are best off in the form of questions, like what if you did this or what if you did that, or what were you going for here? And because the goal is not for us to write your book. The goal is for you to write your book. It's your book. It's not my book. It's not anybody else's book. So, yeah, that the art of critique. You know what? Isn't that how you raise a child? Right?
Yes.
Absolutely.
I want to go first for wow, what a fantastic thing you did, as opposed to zooming in on the thing that the kid did wrong. My mom was a school teacher, fifth grade teacher, and history teacher, and a drama teacher. And she used to say that she'd hand out a test, and she was always amused that there would be certain kids in the program who would always turn the page over, find the thing they didn't understand, say, I don't get it. So she says, why don't you look for the 18 questions you do get first? That's not how critique works. You don't look through one and say, you used this word wrong. That's not the right word.
Well,
that's just bragging.
I don't know if you've always been this way or if this is just the right time in your life to be doing this, but this is, you have a touch. There's a line that actually Bob Berg sent it out in an email today, but I know that it was a line that you had written in probably, I don't remember which book, to be honest with you, but it was something along the lines of, I'm drawing a complete blank. That's what happens now that I'm in my 60s. I draw blanks. But it'll swing
back around.
Yeah, something about being strong in your persistence, but soft in your touch. And I didn't do it exactly right, but anyway, he used that. And I sent back, said, I love that line. He said, well, you know who wrote it.
That's pretty and cute.
Can I add here to it? If you're thinking about doing a book, even if you're thinking about like co-authoring, like Jeff and I did, it changed me fundamentally as a person. I don't know how that happened. I didn't get into it for that reason. And I'm so different. I'm happy different, but I can't believe it. So, I mean, even if you're getting into this to say yes to something you haven't said yes to, I mean, do it for that reason alone. I mean, just even if you have any little spark of a, you know, wanting to be a writer or wanting to having my story in a book like that, even though it's not me by name, there's so much of me in that book. Yes. It feels like I had a book written about me. And
have a book written about you.
Yeah. Your personality, your life, the way you teach people, it's all part of the fabric of the story.
Yeah. Yeah. And may I say that having spent time in direct sales, it illuminates the very best of what building people and having character and leadership. I mean, it's just a brilliant book. The two of you did an amazing job.
I'm going to cry.
Thank you so much.
It's so good. It's so good. Yeah, I mean, I felt sometimes isolated in direct sales because there were so many leaders that just, you know, step over the people that are in their organization and they don't really lead them and they don't really build them and encourage them. And, you know, there's just so much beauty in the book.
What a missed opportunity for the ones that are doing that.
Yes.
Because, I mean, I'm the one that's a better person because I learned how to raise people up.
Yeah. And you end up with friendships all over the world. I mean, John and I still have friends all over the world that, you know, if we're in Singapore, all we have to do is let them know we're coming and they'll be like, yay, and, you know, we'll get together. It's just, it's the best. You know, when you work that way, you do build people.
You know, I don't know, some folks of you here will know Kathy Loughman, who is and we had a coaching call today with just two people, Kathy and Molly Marty. And she said something that I just adored, and it's really appropriate to share. She said, this week I had kind of a crisis. I had several other long-term commitments, and I came to a point of realizing that I had these three things going on. I had this book, and I had this second thing, and I had this third thing, and I wasn't going to be able to do all of them. Something's going to have to give. She said, so I asked myself, a year from now, if I look back at the past year, how will I feel? Actually, somebody asked her, how will you feel if you look back a year from now and you hadn't done the book? What choice would you make? And she said, oh God, I got to do the book. It's no choice. If it's a year from now, I'm looking back, I got to make the book happen. And so she dropped the other two commitments just to keep on with the book. And I was just so charmed by that because that is how it is. It's like that question, what if your grandfather, what if your grandmother, your great-grandmother, your mom had put her life down in between two covers of a book like Joe Martino's book? So, yeah, if you have it in you, and you do, as like Anna says.
And a year ago we started, I wouldn't have known. were just doing this a year ago. We were just starting this a year ago. Really, right?
More or less. I think we started in March or April or something
but
like that.
But still, that's so right. Anyway.
And not to sound corny, but the world, I believe this to be true. The world is a better place because of your book, you know?
Oh, much better.
Just true. It's just true.
Oh, look at Jeff. He's going, oh.
And also, though, you know, your book was a gem when it was finally finished and done. And after you'd been through the editing process, you had taken it and turned it into a real gem. And that's the piece that I have watched John for years and years say, look at this book. There's great ideas. There's great concepts. But the book is half baked. It wasn't put together well. And so it's just not going to draw people. It has a terrible cover and it's self-published. And, you know, it's just wasn't going to work. And so I feel like, you know, you guys took the time to craft it and to really make it a perfect book that expressed exactly what you wanted to express. And that's what the Writing Mastery Roadmap mentorship program is about writing the book that's right for you, but taking it to the level where you really produce the book that you feel so dear and close to, but also proud of.
Well, thank you. And your words mean so much to me. And the truth is, and John, the books that you've written, the work you guys have done, I'm one of these people that I hope someday when we're all in heaven, we actually get to see how many people we never even met that it meant something to. And I know in this course alone, not even including all the great books that you've written, but in this course alone, the exponential factor as we all get better at what we're doing and we do things that matter and all that. And that's a whole lot of that. It's got to come back to Grandpa John here. I'm just saying. it's going to.
Grandpa John.
It's all good. And I know we're running over, but I got to get you to talk about one more thing. Because there's this great book that's about to be released this summer. And I want people to go ahead and pre-order it. And I want them to do it today. So do you mind speaking a little bit? I hear you have another book coming out in some type.
Sounds like you may be talking about the next Chief Finn book.
I just might be.
So some of you watching, listening right now may know the first two books, Steel Fear and Cold Fear. And it's a funny thing that happened when Brandon and I wrote Steel Fear.
which takes place, the whole book takes place on an aircraft carrier, which is for most people, including myself, a completely alien, foreign, bizarre environment. I didn't have a clue what life on a carrier was like. 6,000 people on this metal tube, roughly the size of the Empire State Building on its side, plugged up and dropped in the Pacific Ocean for 6 months. See you later. And not only physically, but sort of socially and structurally and sociologically and emotionally, it's such a fascinating environment. And of course, into that, you drop a serial killer and a traumatized, memory damaged Navy SEAL and various characters. It was really fun. It was really fun. But we also, in the process, what we did was once that book was out, we realized, well, you know, if we're going to be more of these, every one of them's got to be in some unusual, different environment. So for book two, I thought, we'll go to Iceland. Never been to Iceland. Iceland's really, really weird and strange and magnificent and different than anything else on the planet. So book three is coming out now. Book two was last year, Iceland. Book three is Blind Fear, and it's coming out this summer, coming out in July. And the environment this time is Puerto Rico in the middle of a killer hurricane. And I've said before, I'm fond of saying that Steel Fear was really a leadership parable disguised as a thriller. So if Steel Fear was about leadership, Cold Fear was about friendship and Finn coming to grips with it, whether or not he was capable of being a friend or having a friend. And he's trying to find his best friend's killer. And it doesn't even dawn on him that person was a friend until Finn is kind of putting the pieces of his own life back together again. Well, if Steel Fear is about leadership and Cold Fear is about friendship, Blind Fear is about family. And it's about abandonment and recovery. It's the book opens up with two young children frolicking in their tropical paradise, the beaches of Vieques off the coast of Puerto Rico. And at the end of this chapter, something nefarious happens. I can't say what, because if I told you, well, you know. And so Finn spends the entire book, for reasons he doesn't even understand himself entirely, looking for these two lost children. And in a way, he's also looking for his own lost childhood. And it was just an absolute blast to write. Like all these books, it's an adventure, it's a thriller, stuff happens, there's a mystery, there's action. But on a whole nother level, it's like a character study of this very human this human drama, human comedy, human situation. What is it like to be a damaged human being in a dangerous world, trying to kind of figure out who you are and why you're here and what you're supposed to do next? So I hope everybody gets it, and I hope everybody reads it and enjoys it.
Well, you know, you and I didn't talk about this ahead of time, so I don't know if I should say this or not, but I've actually already pre-ordered a copy. When you and Anna come to Texas and you're signing books, I'm going to go buy one from that book retailer because I want them to benefit from bringing you guys in.
They appreciate it. Those bookstores, man. I'm doing a book tour. I'm going to San Diego, La Jolla, Los Angeles, going to Waco, Texas, Dallas, Texas, Nashville, St. Louis, Manhattan. Brandon's going to Miami. I'm not going to make that one. And we're doing a bunch of cool events online with Don Bentley, the Tom Clancy writer, and a handful of others. So it's going to be a really jam-packed book tour. And yeah, if you have a chance to come out and see me at one of those tours, we can see each other face-to-face, press hands, talk, chat, I'll sign your book. And if you do come, buy a book at the store, because the store owners really want you to, that's what makes these events successful to them.
Yes.
What makes them successful to me is if I get to see you. What makes it successful to them is if people come and they buy books, and then they'll invite me back next year. So
right, it's doing business with local companies, and I love that.
That's right. All indie bookstores, no chains here, baby.
I want you to do the same thing you did in Connecticut when I drove down to see you, because you made me like a hero for like 5 minutes. You came in the door, and the bookseller was standing there with me and my friend, and I saw you and you saw me and you did the air gun thing. And the bookstore owner said, "Oh, you know him?" I'm like, "Yes, I do."
Well, this one, awesome. after I've already got my copies that I'll be getting it and I've already ordered, John actually sent me something to read and it made my day. And I was sitting there going through it, and the writing is so good. Your writing gets better with every one of these. And you're already got way up here, but your writing gets better. And I would read a passage, and I would text it to John. I was like, this is incredible. Yes.
That's what his editor said at the publisher, too. The publisher, the editor is really a really good editor. He's and great. She came back and said, this third book is better than number two, which was better than number one. Okay, and number one was nominated for a Barry Award.
So here's the inside story on that. And this is just God's honest truth. This is not false modesty. This is what the experience of a writer is. It doesn't matter if you're professional, you're paid for it. It doesn't matter what kind of writer. If you're writing and you put your work out there, you're a writer. So when I was finishing up the manuscript for Blind Fear, it had been hard to write, and I sent it in, and I waited a couple of weeks, and I was on pins and needles because I was just like, I hope that this comes close to the first two, because the first two had a lot of fans, had done really well, and the third one is very different in some ways. And I thought, oh man, I hope this is going to be okay. And she sent me her editorial letter, which is the letter the editor sends you that gives the initial critique, and it always starts with what she loves, followed by what guests, right? Because she's a good editor. And I opened up the email, and she, in the first paragraph, she said she thought this was the best Finn book yet. I was like, oh. I was like Sally Field at the Academy Awards. She liked it. She really liked it. I was actually so surprised. I was so surprised. So I always love it when other people love the stories that I love too. I wouldn't write it if I didn't love it.
Well, you're writing so good. I'm not going to say what the sentences were, but there was one little spot. You had just written two sentences, and I went, oh my God. And it's like, I was fanboying again. I just did it again.
Lori Walsh wanted me to say, thank you, John, for reminding me of my dad. Wow. He was a Navy man, lived on submarines, was in Greenland, and slept in torpedo tubes and cooked for 6,000 Navy personnel.
Oh, my goodness. Man. Wow.
That's amazing, isn't that?
Wow. Wow.
Thank your dad for his service.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I will end up keeping you two here till you leave for your trip on Saturday. I know me. I just know how I am. But we want to thank you guys so much. We thank obviously you. Love you. We want our followers to love you. It's just such an honor and an absolute amazing experience to have you guys on the show tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, my friends.
Thank you so much. So,
everybody, we love you. Please go online. Amazon reviews are huge. Amazon ratings, and they keep growing. And we keep, every time I see one, we'll post it and we'll share you that you did it. But just please, please keep doing that. And Lisa and I love you to death. So,
yeah, love you, everybody.
Good night.
Good night, everyone.